everyone, this is VerticDesigns here, and we have an exciting new update to Photoshop 2020. Some of the features that we'll be talking about in this video are cloud documents, improvements to presets, new object selection tool, consistent transform behavior, improved properties panel, smart object to layers, enhanced transform wrap, and other enhancements to Photoshop. As soon as you update Photoshop, you'll notice, first of all, the home screen is a little bit more different. You'll have same as normal, same as before, but this time it is more cloud-based. So basically, you can either save your files onto your computer, or you can upload them to the cloud. As you can see over here, we have a cloud's documents right here. Photoshop have pretty much made it easier for you to share your files from your PC to your tablet or to your smartphone, and it is all done with cloud-based. So starting off with the first one, this is honestly my personal favorite one, and that is the object selection tool. To get to it, you can go to the fourth tool down, right click on it, and then go to the object selection tool. Now Photoshop will put it at the top, so you can pretty much access it from here, or you can press W on your keyboard. The way that this works is it uses Adobe Sensei, which is a smart AI, and it is honestly getting better and better each time. So we can either click on select subject or we can select the subject itself. Now, if you click on it, normally it'll do quite a good job of detecting it. If it's an easy background, it will get it straight away. But if it's a bit more of a difficult background, it will try its best to select the object. So I'm just going to undo it. The other way would just be to left click and get yourself a box around the object, and it will detect the outline of it. If you've got some areas inside, you can hold Alt and then left click and drag it out to deselect that area. Same as down here. And then also here too. As you can see up here, the glasses are out of it, so we're gonna get a box there too. And as you can see, it's done a pretty good job of quickly selecting it. This tool is also tied in with the quick selection tool, so if you wanted to, you can use both of them at the same time. You could switch between the object selection and the quick selection tool. So if I wanted to, I can always go to the quick selection tool and edit it with this too. The selection will remain there, and you don't really have to do anything else. Just like the other selection tools, you have the options at the top right here. So you'll have the first one, which will only let you create one of the selection. This one will let you add on to it. So if you aren't able to add on to it, all you gotta do is go over here, and that will let you do it as well. You have subtract, and then you have add as well inside. With this tool, you have two modes. You can either use a rectangle, or you can even go with a manual lasso tool, so you can wrap yourself around the area. Now I'm gonna go back to this one, and pretty much some of the other ones are displayed right here. So if you wanted to, you can auto enhance or object subtract. Another really cool thing about this is you can go to select the mask and you can do it live as it is. And what I mean by this is if you wanted to, you can edit it and still have the selection. So for example, as you can see, a part of the shoulder right here isn't selected. So we're gonna get ourselves the selection tool and only select the edge. We're also going to use the refine edge tool. So this is the tool right here, and we're gonna fix up the hair. So pretty much once you're happy with it, all you got to do is go down here to output 2, get yourself a new layer, and then press OK, and there we go. Your background is now gone. It is that simple with this tool. It's literally a one click selection. Here's another example for you. We've got this image right here. So if you wanted to, we can select this area right here and select the person right here. And then once it's selected, get yourself a mask, and there we go. And as you can see, it's done a pretty good job of selecting the person. Sometimes you will have obviously the areas which you didn't do very well on, but you can always edit this like I showed you with the other image. This tool comes in handy, especially if you have a lot more objects in your image. For example, this right here, you can get yourself the object selection, select this area right here, also get that bit there, but also deselect that area. You can go over and get yourself a human saturation and then just pretty much change the color in here. You can increase it, decrease it, play about with the light, and so much more. For some of you that know presets, you'll know that you can easily get yourself some templates that have already been created. Now, Adobe has made this a lot more easier if you go to Window and get yourself the gradient, which is right here. You can get yourself some gradients and also get yourself some patterns. So let's go over the patterns first. Now, as you know, you have your own pattern, which is right here. These are all your patterns that you have created. You can easily just drag and drop them into here, like so. There's also some other ones that have been added. So for example, trees, grass, water, and gradients right here. This is a folder that I created. You can create your own folders and pretty much put all your patterns in here or any textures that you have. And this just makes it easier because you can easily just drag and drop them into your boxes. For example, if you want to just drag and drop them into here, like so. So if you wanted to, you can just drag and drop yourself, let's say, a tree pattern onto here. As you can see, that is pretty cool. It just saves a lot of time from messing around and going to the blending options. Same again for the gradients. If we wanted to, we can have our own right here, as you can see, or we can open up some other ones. Now I'm gonna close mine and I'm going to get ourselves, let's say, some reds with some cloud and some greens and just drag and drop them into the image. If you wanted to, you have two ways. You can either drag and drop them into the box or you can drag it into the layer itself. This just saves a lot of time from having to create your own patterns and gradients. You can also edit this. So if you want to, you can drag it up and make it larger or you can minimize it. And you can even remove it from here by right clicking on it and then going to close. And then once again, going to close. If you wanted to, you can edit it. So if you drag and dropped it into the shape, you'll have this option right here. You can change the gradient, the angle. You can also edit the scale, make it a little bit smaller. You also have some basic colors in the swatches. So RGB, you have some light ones, purple, and some other colors. These are already made up, so you can get yourself some sampling from here. So for some of you that have been using Photoshop for a while, you will know that if you press Ctrl T to resize your image, normally you would hold Shift to maintain the aspect ratio. But with the update, they've made it so it automatically locks the aspect ratio. So when you do press Shift, it will actually make it so it toggles it so it's off. And for some of us, this is a little bit weird to get used to because we're used to just pretty much pressing Ctrl T and holding Shift to maintain aspect ratio. In the new update, what they've pretty much done is they've updated the scale options right here. So you have the lock icon right here. This is the chain icon. And this pretty much lets you toggle the aspect ratio. So if you wanted to, you could turn it off. And now if you hold Shift and you scale this down, it will maintain the aspect ratio. And pretty much how it works is vice versa. If you have it turned on and you hold Shift, it will toggle it off. If you want it to be completely removed and back to the old way, all you got to do is go to Edit, go down to Preferences, go into General, and then in General, all you got to do is take this one right here that says Use Legacy Free Transform. This will pretty much set it back to the old way that you used to use the Transform tool. Another useful thing about this chain icon right here is that if you toggle it off or toggle it on, Photoshop will remember that you have it turned off or turned on. So if you do close Photoshop and reopen it, it will remember your settings. For some of you that like to look at the properties for the image, you can go to Window and go down to Properties, and everything has pretty much been moved onto here. You have the information about the canvas, you have rulers and grids, guides, and you have some quick actions right here that you can easily get to. This just makes it easier because everything is all in one place. So if you wanted to, you can get yourself a ruler, you could toggle it on, you can get yourself a grid, You can get yourself a transparent background. Some other options right here. You can even get yourself a fill. So the quick actions are pretty much all around here. So for example, image, trim, you have trim right here. So you pretty much have them all here. So if you wanted to, you can crop it. And there you go. It's a lot quicker. Moving on to a little new improvement. Now, this isn't major, but it is really helpful. I've always wanted this. So it is pretty much if you have a bunch of layers and let's say you want to convert them into a smart object. Now, once you've actually converted them into a smart object, that's it. You can't really go back. Now, all you can do is right click on it and then you can pretty much can convert to layers. And now you have your layers back and you can edit each one, move them around, do whatever you would like with them. Now, another new thing with Photoshop is if you've got yourself a object or shape, you can't erase it unless you convert it into a layer. So as you can see, if I try to edit this shape, it wouldn't let me if I tried to erase it. All you have to do is right click on it and then go to rasterize layer and then you can actually cut through it. All right, so moving on to the next one, we have the content aware fill. This has been updated and now it is more advanced, so you can pretty much have more options. A lot of you know the content aware, you can remove unwanted objects. Now, this one is a little bit more advanced, so you can actually have more options to it. But you won't be able to get it normally, so you need to select an area. You can either select the subject or select the area. I'm gonna use the object selection tool and then left click and get ourselves a box right here. We don't want this bit here, so I'm going to remove that bit. Also this bit here too. And we're going to need this bit here. Right, so now that I've selected the person, you want to go to edit, and then you have content aware fill. Normally if you press shift and F5, it'll quickly bring it up for you, so it'll give you this right here, the fill. Now, this one's a little bit more different because if you go to edit, go to content aware, it'll bring you to a completely new area. So what you'll have on the screen is you'll have the work area right here, the project that you're working on. So same as normal. You have the tools and then you have the content aware options. And this is the preview right here. So this is what you will see. The green area is the area in which it will use to copy the textures over. The way that this works is you have the green area. The green area, which you can change to any color that you wanted to, is the area which it'll pick the textures and copy them over into this bit here, so where the object is. And as you can see in the preview, it's done a really good job of making it look more normal and natural, as if it's never even there. You have the opacity here, so if you wanted to, you can increase it or decrease it. You can also toggle it off, completely hide it. If you wanted to, you can even invert it. So you can go over to this one and this is the opposite areas. But the green area is usually the bits it will use to copy over to the middle area. You have the sampling area options. You can either have auto, which will automatically detect the best areas. You have rectangular. And then the very last one is custom. So if you click on this one, this will come up and it'll basically say what you're going to need to do is you're going to need to use the brush tool and give it some area where you want it to use. If we go over to the first one, which is the brush tool right here, make sure it's on a plus and change the scale to something a little bit bigger. You can select the areas that you want to use. So let's say we want some of the areas here. And then we also want some of this bit here. And as you can see, it's slowly adding the textures. Auto is usually the best one because it will detect which areas are the best. So normally you can just leave on that one. Next up, you'll have the color adaptive. Now this one, you can have none, default, high, and very high. You can mess around with these settings and see what you prefer. You can keep on looking in the preview. Now, if you put it too high, sometimes it might throw it off and it won't look as good. It'll just look more blurry. Once you're happy with it and you want to save it, all you got to do is go to output 2 and then you can either keep it on the current layer, have a new layer or duplicate it. I normally like to create a new layer and then I press OK. And there we go. Some bits will be left behind. So if you wanted to, you can merge these two together. And then to get rid of the outline, you get the healing brush tool, right click on it and then rasterize the layer. make the healing brush tool a little bit bigger with the square bracket. And yeah, that's not too bad. It's a little bit blurry here, but you can always edit it and just make it a little bit better if you wanted to. All right, so here's another example. We have the car with a person and a flashlight. What we're gonna do with this one is we're gonna go over to the selection tool, create ourselves a box where the object is, and then we're gonna go over to edit, content aware fill. And then as you can see, by default, that has done a pretty good job on removing the object. So as you can see from the preview, that's pretty good. We're gonna put this one to high, see what it looks like. And that is not looking too bad. Once you're happy with it, same as last time, output 2, and then press OK. And as you can see, it is now gone. Now there is a bit of a problem here, as you can see, but it isn't something too big. It's easily fixable if we get the clone tool, make it a little bit smaller, change it to a hard feather, and then copy this over from here, like so. You can copy it from above. You can merge these two together, and then convert to a layer, and there we go, fixed. Down here, there's a bit of a problem here too, so let's go over to the healing brush tool. We'll fix this bit there. Moving on to another new feature, this is the wrap tool. For some of you that already know, you already have a puppet wrap, which is quite useful, but this one is newer and it's a lot easier to use. If we got ourselves an image, for example, we have this building right here, we're just gonna scale it down. So if you hold Alt on your keyboard and use the scroll wheel to go down to zoom out, and then you hold Alt and make this a little bit smaller. Let's say we didn't want the background, so we can easily go ahead and use the new object selection tool and select the object. Then once you've selected the object, just create yourself a mask. And then once you've got yourself a mask, you will need to convert this into a smart object. Now that you've got yourself a smart object right here, as you can see, this is the building. Let's say we wanted to create a reflection on a, let's say, crystal ball or something, and the building needs to wrap itself around the ball itself. All you got to do is go to edit and go down to transform and then wrap. You have some points that are already being created for you, and all you do is pretty much drag these points. So you can put this up as it is. You can pretty much move it to what you prefer and wrap it around the object itself. You could drag the points to where you want them to go. And this just gives it that effect that is on the shape itself. If you wanted some extra points, you can hold Alt and this will give you a line. So you can pretty much create yourself a vertical line. This will create you a vertical and horizontal line in the middle. And this will just let you edit it even more. You can rotate it like this. Move it up. Okay, so once you're happy with it, all you gotta do is double left click on it and that will apply it. Or you can simply right click on it and then click on place. And then you have it like so. Another thing that they've added that I really like, you can now zoom in to any of your images. So for example, if we have some text over here, we have an image, we have some shapes. We want to, let's say, get from this one to this one really quick. We can easily hold Alt and then click on the thumbnail and that will zoom right into it. And just saves a lot of time because you can quickly switch through it like so. And it's just really simple. Let's say we're zoomed out and we want to zoom back in. You can just hold Alt, click on the thumbnail and you're back to it. It's really quick and snappy, so it's great. And yeah, that is pretty much most of the features and improvements that have been added to Photoshop. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up and leave a comment on what you thought of it. I will see you all in my next video. Bye.